primary memory. We also call it as a main memory. Why? Because the microprocessor is going to deal with all the stuff which are in main memory only. It understands only main memory. It has nothing to do with the secondary memory. So the primary memory, main memory is a metal oxide memory to store the program, to store the data which is under execution. That means the microprocessor is working on it or is going to work on it. And this is directly accessible to CPU. Right? Now the organization of main memory is like this. You have different words kept like this. Okay? And all these words are being addressed like this. Address 0 to n minus 1. So how many addressing can be done? 2 to the power n. In this case, 2 to the power n addressing can be done. So if you have a 32-bit processor, 2 to the power 32 addressing can be done. You have 64, 2 to the power 64 addressing can be done. And all will have a same word length. That means if your word length is 32-bit, these are 32 bits. 64 bits, 128 bits. So this is the organization of the main memory. So you have just seen the figure that the word length 8-bit, 16-bit, 24. And the higher the word length, the more powerful computer will be. We start with 0 and the largest number that the computer can support. I just said 2 to the power n. It may not support. The RAM, your processor may support maybe 2 to the power say 32 and your system may be 64 bit. Okay. So there can be a variation. So what we do is we deal with the or we talk about the address lines, address bus. So the address bus describes your microprocessor. Address bus say is of n or has n lines. You say my computer is 2 to the power n. Means my computer is n bit processor or n bit computer. Now memories, there are two things. You want to get the data from the memory, and once you are done, you want to replace it with that data. So you want to read or write the memory. There are memories where you can permanently store the data. These are called read only memories. There are memories where only you can access or read or write the data till the power is on. We call them as a random access memory. But we have variations of this RAM and ROM. Random access memory and ROM also have various variations. RAM, random access memory. Random access memory, because the name says random access memory, so if you have this formation of your primary memory or RAM, you don't, and this is say 32 bit, you don't have to, if you want to access this data, you don't have to go to all the way to get this data. Random access memory means you want to access, you can directly go to this you can say sector or block of that memory. Okay. The instruction and data are stored in the RAM of the computer. RAM of the computer. See, this RAM, random access memory, this is a volatile memory. Means it will lose all the data as soon as the power will go. And now RAMs are in gigabytes. You see your computer, it will be at least 2 GB RAM or 4 GB or say 8 GB RAM. This is a huge increase in the RAM as compared to what was 7 or 8 years ago. The access time is also very good, 20 to 80 nanosecond. Nanosecond means 10 to the power 9 seconds. Say s by 10 to the power 9. So this is very fast. Now RAM can be classified into two categories. One is your dynamic RAM, the other is your static RAM. What is dynamic RAM? Dynamic RAM actually consists of transistor and capacitor. That is, the electric charge is stored here. As I said, 1 and 0, these bits are nothing but the electric charge only, voltages only. And these DRAMs are smaller, they are cheaper, and they are slower memories. Why this DRAM is slower? You ought to ask this question. Because, you know, this has capacitor. And capacitor tend to lose charge over a period of time. So they need to be refreshed again and again. They need to be refreshed again and again. So for that, the CPU times or CPU cycles goes in refreshing. That is why it becomes slower. So DRAM is used in primary storage area and it is available in various forms like EDORAM, extended data output RAM, SDRAM, synchronous DRAM and DDR SDRAM. What is static RAM? The type of RAM is large in physical size, but this is expensive and faster memories. Why? It will not use capacitor. It will use flip-flop. Flip-flop is what? You can have J flip flop, D flip flop, T flip flop, JK flip flop, all these types of flip flop are there. And flip flop are nothing but simple NAND or NOR gate circuitry which are able to keep one bit of data or one bit of charge or one bit of voltage. Now, this flip flop stores data and it will not require any refreshing. Because, as I said, NOR and NAND gates, so you don't need to refresh it again and again. And static RAM is also volatile. And it is quite easier to use as compared to DRAM, and quite specialized application it finds in its usage. Now we come to read-only memory. What is read-only memory? As the name is suggesting, you can only do the read operation. Your manufacturer has given something, it has written something on that ROM, and you cannot overwrite it. You cannot change it. But there are variations also. And see, ROM contains some data. When your computer is switched off, and you switch on again, how does it boot? Or before the booting process or the initial booting process, what happens? The content of the ROM only takes place in or takes the main base of making your computer boot. So the information kept in ROM, if you open your system, it will give you HP or Dell or IBM. What is there? It is coming from the read-only memory which the manufacturer has given to you. So it will contain the essential instructions such as your interrupt service routines or monitor program controlling the machine. So instructions that are needed to start also or boot the computer, they are also stored in ROM. ROMs are slower as compared to RAMs, as you see, when they will be a considerable time when your computer is going to boot up. Even your mobile, you know, it will show Apple or Samsung. So that time, that thing is coming from ROM. So there are various flavors or variations of ROM. First is your PROM. PROM is what? Programmable read-only memory. This ROM can be programmed even after your manufacturer has given it to you. Means you can use a PROM program a circuit. But once you program it, it becomes like ROM. You cannot change it again. Then you have EPROM. EPROM. EPROM means erasable programmable read-only memory. The contents now can be erased and the memory can be reprogrammed also. If you want to erase the data, then you will use ultraviolet light. This EPROM is exposed to the ultraviolet light and then it can be programmed using a PROM programmer circuit. While EPROM is in usage, it exactly behaves like a ROM. That means the information can only be read. You cannot write there. That is the beauty of ROM. That is the categorization of ROM. Then you have EEPROM. EEPROM. See, the content of this type of ROM can now be erased and then can be reprogrammed using electric signals. Now, if you have something in RAM, said very important thing is going on in your RAM and sometimes your power is switched off or some problem comes. Now, when you again restart your system, this RAM will not contain anything. How about storing whatever is in RAM while you are working on a EEPROM? And once your computer starts, transfer this EEPROM again to RAM so that your system starts on the original position or original situation where it went off. See, when you hibernate your computer or you sleep your computer, what happens? This exactly happens. Means your system will boot up or will come to life again with the similar configuration situation you were in. Right? So nowadays, RAMs and EEPROMs, they are integrated in a single chip. Cache memory. This is a very special high speed memory. And you have very high speed static RAMs here. Why it is very fast? It is used to hold frequently accessed data and instruction. I'll give an example. You have 10 shoes. This is your wardrobe. You have kept 8 shoes here. And you have kept 2 shoes here. Every day you use these 2 shoes. While you are partying, you will go to this area to get another shoe. Shoe or boot, you can say. Now, every day you're using this only. So, why not to, there is one possibility also. There is your wardrobe containing 10 boots. You have to go again and again to fetch your boots or your shoes. So, the key idea is whatever you are using every day or those things which are used frequently, why not to keep here? This is similar with your computer also. Now, your CPU is again and again dealing with your RAM for your 10 boots. But it is frequently using 2 boots only. So why not to keep these two boots in the memory, which CPU, which is quite faster or very faster than the your RAM. So now CPU is going to deal with this only. And whenever it requires, it will give a cache miss. So you can easily bring the third one here, fourth one here. So our key idea is we want our CPU to work, not sit idle. So there we have a cache memory which is small, expensive but fast, which is placed between your main memory and your CPU. So if your CPU gets what it requires from the RAM, we call it as it is a cache hit. And if you have a very good cache hit rate, you say your system is very good. But if you have cache miss, then ultimately you have to bring that boot or shoes here or instructional data here. So that will be the cache miss. So if you want to access the frequently used data or instruction, you have to keep it in the cache memory. This is what the cache memory does. So you can have two caches, L1 cache or L2 cache. CPU, the cache which is inside your CPU is called the L1 or level 1 cache. It is faster than the L2 cache, which is not in, on the CPU, but it is on the motherboard where the CPU is placed. Though it is there, but there will be some time in getting this data or instruction because it is outside the CPU, which is inside the CPU, which is L1, outside the CPU, L2, but on the motherboard. There are caches also, which are, because we have level 3, level 4 caches also. Then we come to the secondary memory. Secondary memory has gained importance because primary memory loses its data when the power is switched off. So you want to have, and then primary memory is limited also because it is very expensive. You cannot have, the maximum you can have is 4GB, 8GB like this. How about dealing with terabytes of data? And you want that data to be intact when the power goes off. So you ought to have some external memory or some memory where the data is permanent. You don't lose it after your power surge or power spike or anything goes, like you switch off your computer. So this is an additional storage which is called the secondary memory, why this name has come. And this is not the part of the main computer. This secondary storage can be fixed. You will see the system in your cabinet or the disk in the cabinet. Or you can have this storage media as movable also, removable also, like your pen drives, like your data drives. So why do we need a secondary memory? There are two reasons. First, you want permanency. RAM is volatile. That means it will, as the electricity is turned off, it is going to lose the data. And secondary storage will not lose the data if the electricity is turned off. The portability, you cannot take your ROM outside every time. If you want to take data from one side to another, one computer to another, you want movability, portability, then you have this storage, secondary storage, like your CDs, like your DVDs, like your Blu-ray discs, like your flash drives. So the secondary storage media, this can be magnetic, this can be optical, this can be solid state. So what is magnetic storage media? Like your hard disk, floppy has already gone, but we'll talk about this floppy magnetic tape. Magnet, these all have a magnetic sensitive material, and clockwise or anti-clockwise, these can be magnetized, and which will be interpreted later as 1 or 0. The floppy disk, which has already gone, means they are no longer in use. So they were made of mylar with the magnetic coating on it, and they have a protective plastic envelope. And these were the oldest type of portable storage devices. And they were holding just 1.44 MB of data. See, today you have an MP3 song, you ought to have 3 to 4 MB for that. Even this was very smaller. But people used to work on it and they used to solve their purposes. Then you have hard disk. Now hard disk, let me show you the diagram first. This is the hard disk. These all are called platters. These one platter, this is the front view. And if you see the top view from here, this is how it is seen. So this rotates. All these platters, they are round shaped, they rotate. And they have various tracks. And in these tracks, you have sectors. This sector is going to contain the data. And this is the read-write head. This read-write head will go to certain track and then sector. And from this sector, it will fetch the data or understand the data or give it to the memory. These are various surfaces, the top surface and the lower surface. The reading and writing can be done on both the sides. And this is the cylinder. There has to be a spindle by which this rotates. So let us come back. So the hard disk consists of the circular disk, which we just called as platter, which are mounted on a spindle. So this is a spindle. This is how they are mounted. And both these surfaces can be used for storing the data, except the top one and the bottom one. So the information recorded, you have to rotate the disk, and by magnetic read and write head, you just understand the data. And you have a common arm here, where this head is mounted. The arm moves over the surface of the rotating disk, as you see in this figure. So this is how hard disk work. The information which is recorded on each of the disk is in the form of concentric circles. We call it as a track, and you have sectors inside it. So this sector is where the data is stored. You have external drives, internal drives. So you can, they can be portable, and the storage capacity is very large. Gigabytes and terabytes of memory you can store. Now we come to the optical storage media. The optical storage media, the information is stored and read using a laser beam. And you have pits and ridges. These pits and ridges, they amount to 1 and 0, that is the binary. So you can have a CD, you can have a DVD, you can have a Blu-ray now. So what is a compact disc? Compact disc, it can store about 700 MB of data. And you need to have a CD drive on your computer to read this. So the bits which are 0 and 1, they are encoded in the transition between your rays, ridges and edge bits. You will not be able to see. You have to use a microscope to see this. And they are lined up in a spiral-like pattern. So this pattern is then stamped to a 1.2 mm clear polycarbonate disc. That is why we call it as a CD, polycarbonate disc, which is then covered with super thin coating of reflective metal. It may be aluminium or gold, and then a label. So to read the data, you need to use a infrared laser. You will see a red light, which is through the CD's polycarbonate substrate. And the wavelength of light, this bounce off the mirror-like reflective, this bounce off, this is going here and this is going to reflect. So the pits and ridges pass different amount of data, and the fluctuation of reflected beam, which is coming to the laser sensor, it transform it into ones and zeros, the amount of light which is coming back. So there are three types of CDs, CD-ROM, CDR and CDRW. CD-ROM stands for compact disc read-only memory. So once this CD-ROM is given by the manufacturer, you cannot change it. You can just read it. Like this text, audio, video distribution of games, encyclopedias and application software, they are all given in the CD-ROM. How about CDR? CDR is compact disc recordable. These are the discs you can write only once. Means you can just write once and you cannot modify or erase the data again. Then you have another variation which is called CDRW. This is compact disc rewritable. Now you can read it, write once, then read, then again you can write. So up till this CD is working fine. So you ought to have a CDRW drive in your computer so that you can deal with this CDRW. Then you have DVD. DVD is what? DVD is digital versatile disc. So it is just like a CD, use a similar technology, but now the wavelength of red laser which is used has a narrower beam. The beam has gone narrower. So this will allow the capacity to be more than 700. And this is a significant advancement in the portable storage technology. So this DVD consists of two half thickness, the 0.6 mm CD like disc, which are glued back to back. So it protects the delicate reflective coating as it's on the inside the disc. And it makes possible to have a double sided DVDs, which is going to store the double data which a disc can contain. So DVD holds 4.7 GB to 17 GB of data. That means you can even store a movie or a series of a movie in a DVD. So there are three varieties: DVD-ROM, DVD-R and DVD-RW. Now we come to Blu-ray disc. Blu-ray disc, this is an optical storage media latest which can store high definition audio and video, specifically made for multimedia content only. It looks like exactly as CD and DVD, but it can store in single layer 27 GB and in double layer 54 GB. Where the CDs and DVDs, they use red laser. The Blu-ray, as the name suggests, it uses blue laser to read and write data on the disc. Because the wavelength of Blu-ray is shorter, more data per unit area can be stored on the disc. Because you have a shorter wavelength, it is possible to focus also the laser spot with greater precision, and the data can be packed more tightly. So the Blu-ray disc was developed to enable the recording, the rewriting and the playback of HD high definition video, and also storing the large amount of data. Then you have solid state memory, SSD as we call it. Now say Apple computers have SSDs, other computers are also coming with SSDs. This solid state means there are no moving parts, you will not have any spindle, you will not have any arm. So the solid state storage devices are based on electronic circuit with no moving parts, no reels of tape, no spinning disk, no laser beam. So the solid state devices, SSD, they store data using a special type of memory, we call it as a flash memory. This SSD or flash memory is used in your digital cameras, your pen drives and your USB flash drives. Then you have this pen drives. You use it very often. These pen drive, thumb drive or flash drive, these are portable storage media. Recently we are using it. And they are nothing but EEPROM. They are EEPROM based flash memory, which can be, you can erase it, you can write it using your electric signals only. And this is clubbed or coupled with your USB connectors like USB 2, 3, 3.1. You can easily plug and play hot swappable way, you can connect it to the computer. And they have a capacity which is smaller than hard disk but larger than the CD. This is your pen drive.